Okay, so I can hear you right now saying that the crow isn't horror. And didn't I say that this channel would be for spooky stuff only? Well, the crow is spooky adjacent. It's within walking distance of spooky. I mean, there's murder, violence, arson, and Brandon Lee died on set. Shit is dark. Shit is goth, at the very least. And beside all that, this movie is one of my absolute favorites and I just love talking about it. And beside all that, I already have all these retrospectives written from a past project, and I've got some funny shit to say about City of Angels that is currently going to waste. So unless one of you Motor City motherfuckers has anything to say to my reasoning, let's get into it, okay? It's October 30th, Devil's Night, the night before Halloween where inner city Detroit goes up in flames, building by building. It's also the night before Shelley Webster and Eric Draven's wedding, and the night that they both die. Shelley had been fighting tenant eviction in her building, and the gang lord that owned the turf didn't take that too kindly. He sends his goons in to put the fear in Shelley, but it escalates to murder. Eric is shot 2 times and thrown from a 6th-story window to the pavement below. Shelley is viciously assaulted as she watches Eric die, and then dies herself shortly thereafter, her body just giving up from the misery that befell her. A year passes. Shelley and Eric are buried beside each other, but the rest is not peaceful. No justice was ever seen for the crimes committed against them, so something altogether more supernatural has to put the wrong things right. Eric returns under the guidance of a crow to seek revenge on those responsible for his pain. He slaughters his way through the small-time thugs Tintin, Funboy, T-Bird, and Skank, killing them in the order they attacked Shelley and with the things and objects they're known for. Tintin is stabbed through with his own blades, Funboy overdosed on the morphine he deals, T-Bird, the demolitions expert, is blown to bits, and Skank is thrown out of a window just like Eric was 1 year ago. But the story doesn't end there. Even though the 4 that directly attacked and murdered Eric and Shelley are dead, there's another group that's far more dangerous wrapped up in all this. Top Dollar, the gang lord that okayed the violence that happened to Eric and Shelley, has been told of the crow's power by his mystic sister-slash-lover, and is hoping to steal that power. During the intermission of Eric's bloody revenge, he reveals himself as back from the dead to Sarah, a young friend that he and Shelley looked after because her deadbeat, drug-addict mother doesn't. He also reveals himself to Sergeant Albrecht, the cop that first responded to the attack 1 year ago, and who's been demoted within the police force for sticking his nose too far into cases, including the case of what happened to Eric and Shelley.
You're gonna wind up working a school crosswalk.
So Eric has killed one of Top Dollar's main crews, stormed his hideout and slaughtered countless other thugs and criminals, and ruined Top Dollar's big Devil Knight's fun. Top Dollar is optimistic, though. He can rebuild his empire, bigger and better than before. All he needs is the power of the crow. Top Dollar has snatched Sarah and uses Eric's feelings for the fiery little punk to draw him into an ambush. The crow is shot, lifting the magic that protected Eric from harm and making him vulnerable.
Quick impression for you. Caw, caw, bang, fuck, I'm dead!
While Albrecht deals with Top Dollar's bodyguard Grange, and the crow avoids capture by Top Dollar's witchy sister, Eric follows Top Dollar to the roof of the church to save Sarah. Without the crow's powers, though, he's injured and weak and quickly bleeding out. Top Dollar does the classic villain's monologue, explaining to Eric that he was the one that called for Eric's building to be cleared because he wanted to burn it down.
What happened back there with you and your girlfriend? I cleared that building. Hell, nothing in this town happens without my say-so.
Eric uses the last trick he's got up his sleeve to finish this once and for all. Pain.
I have something to give you. I don't want it anymore.
He gives all the pain he had inside himself to Top Dollar and spells his doom. Well, technically, this very pointy gargoyle spells his doom, but that's semantics at this point. Sarah is safe, Albrecht, despite being shot, is hanging on, and Eric is finally able to rest in peace. Shelley comes to collect him herself. Buildings burn, people die, but real love is forever. I am so fucking soft for this movie. Despite my complicated relationship with romance, this just absolutely destroys me every time I watch it. When I think of true love and tragedy, I think of Eric and Shelley. Romeo and Juliet? Who the fuck are they? These two are the epitome of everlasting love. Coming back from the dead to avenge you and your wronged lover against scum that's never seen the consequences of their villainy? Literally crawling out of a grave to howl at the stormy night? So romantic. In ways to romantically impress me, it ranks up there with Beast saving Belle from the wolves. You know, Beast and Eric have a lot in common in terms of how I gauge what's romantic nowadays. Fall in love with a feisty and beautiful brunette? Howl at the sky in rage and confusion? Seek bloody revenge to right wrongs committed against your beloved brunette? Have a rooftop fight scene amongst gargoyles for the honor of your feisty and beautiful brunette? Of course, when it comes to revenge stories like this, there's usually only one plot device that Hollywood falls back on. Really, that male creatives in general fall back on. The violent death of a woman to further a man's story and develop his character. It's called fridging. The trope was named by comic book legend Gail Simone back when she was a comic book blogger. Women in Refrigerators is named for the fate of Alexandria DeWitt, a murdered girlfriend of the Green Lantern whose body is stuffed into a refrigerator and left for her boyfriend to find. It's a noxious, completely unnecessary framing device to motivate a male character to do something heroic. It's been especially ridiculously overused in comics and the movies that comic characters have spawned. Off the top of my head, I can say that Deadpool 2 did it to Vanessa, Thor the Dark World did it to Frigga, and The Dark Knight did it to Rachel. That's just comic book movies, and that's just the immediate response I can give. Imagine how many more pieces of media that kill off women in a bid to make you care more about the male lead I could list if I Googled it for even 1 second. I hate this trope. All women hate this trope. Don't tell us we're being too sensitive about this by telling us that male characters die too. Male characters don't often die in this way. This is a trope specific to women, and it doesn't exist in a vacuum. It can seriously affect how women are viewed. What I'm getting at with this is that the Crow does have fridging. Eric's quest for revenge comes not from his own murder, but from Shelley's. I think even more specifically than that, Shelley had to be violently sexually assaulted to send Eric on his quest for revenge. And that's really shitty. Rape is such a horrific act of violence on someone's body, and using it narratively, especially to drive the story of a man who just witnessed it or heard of it happening, is disgusting and just fucking lazy. Now, all that being said, what's present in The Crow is, at least to me, a less problematic form of fridging. Because they've both died from injuries sustained during the same act of violence, and it's just that Eric was brought back instead of Shelley. Now, why does Eric have to come back instead of Shelley? Wouldn't it be a much more badass story if Shelley were back to take back the power that was stolen from her? Yes, it would be. But the original Crow comic book was written by James O'Barr out of a place of anger and grief when his fiancée was killed by a drunk driver, and Eric is almost like a self-insert of that anger and grief. The story is 100% out of Eric's POV because Eric was, is, and will always be O'Barr and what he was feeling as he wrote the story. And when all is said and done, I might actually put Shelley under the trope, the lost Lenore, in which an absent, presumably dead woman is deeply pined for by a living male and isn't directly presented as disposable, but is instead shown that even in her absence, she'll haunt the protagonist and somehow influence the action of the narrative. There are arguments to be made that that's really no better than fridging, because the woman still has no agency over her own story. But Eric himself softens that blow. Eric truly does love Shelley, and it's played up perfectly with his recklessness in pursuing his revenge. Sure, you can be told that he loves her, but Lee does a fantastic job at showing that he loves her. The strong visceral feelings that come from love are present throughout this movie. This is a man who has died, but finds that his heart is still beating. So what's stopping him from doing anything? He's leaping from rooftops, frantically grappling with a man on the dirty ground of Detroit, blowing up buildings while he stands in them, and charging headfirst into gunfights with a knife. Because why not? This isn't the cold, calculated revenge of a man that has detached himself from the world. This is fiery, messy, wild, and passionate, and done completely in the heat of the moment by a man who is absolutely reeling from being detached from the world. He didn't want to be detached from the world or the woman he loves. And what's more than that, we even know that he loves her, because we see him love her. It's that passion that makes this case of fridging sting less as a female viewer. Eric really loves Shelley, and his heedless headfirst approach shows that. He's died for Shelley, and that accomplished nothing. So now, he's going to kill for her. Her death doesn't further his story. His actions further their story. A much more romantic sentiment, if you ask me.
You're all going to die.
You know, sometimes it's hard to look at something we love critically, because we assume that after we've seen the flaws, we won't love it anymore. And I was a little worried that if I talked too much about the harmful use of tropes, I wouldn't be able to look at The Crow in the same way. But I don't feel any differently about it. I still adore this story, and it's honestly nice to have taken the time to work through what it is about this narrative that makes me like it so much, despite the glaring issues with the use of Shelley throughout. The story, outside of the tropes, is top-notch action movie scripting. The story is simple, vicious revenge. Having such a straightforward motivation helps the story flow. It doesn't get muddled down in extra plot points or character contrivances. Quite a bit of the movie was actually reworked after Lee's accidental death on set, and some of the heavier straight from the comic book sequences were cut. Anyone familiar with the Crow comic will know I'm talking about the Skull Cowboy specifically. The Skull Cowboy is a guide for the souls that find themselves in limbo. It's a less than obvious plot point in the comic, and it would have been even worse in the movie. Without throwing in unnecessary metaphors like that, the plot is kept crisp and on point. If the story doesn't wander, neither will the audience. And then there's the story of Brandon Lee himself. Everyone knows this story. It was huge news back in 93, and it's since become something of an urban legend of the Lee family curse. On the off chance that you don't know the story, Brandon Lee was killed just a few days before principal filming wrapped on The Crow, when a prop gun fired a dummy round that was lodged in the chamber into his abdomen. After 6 hours of surgery, he was pronounced dead at 28 years old. Lee's untimely death has added to The Crow's mythos of pain and misery, and ended up making the movie a critical and commercial success when it came out a year later, as people flocked to the theater to see the movie that killed Brandon Lee. And since that initial success, it's gone on to become a beloved cult classic. And since the themes of this movie are always going to strike a chord with audiences, I'm quite confident in saying that as long as humans walk this planet, this timeless, angsty goth action movie will be beloved. The performances in The Crow are incredible across the board. Lee steals the show as Eric Draven, bringing pain and anger and sadness to the role. Because of his death during the filming of the movie, it almost feels like he haunts it. He conveys everything so naturally and portrays Eric with a confidence that speaks volumes to his talent. Something that reviewers originally harped on was a lack of depth in the character. But where? There is complexity in Eric's character. I don't see where they're not seeing it. Maybe it's clear to me because I've got the original comic taking up as much space in my mind as the movie does, and you get to see inside Eric's head more intimately in the comic. But come on, this isn't a flat character. Eric is a ruthless killer, but he needs to retain his humanity for us to sympathize with him. And he does! Whether or not you would ever personally do the things that Eric does in the name of revenge is beside the point, because you never, for one goddamn second, ever feel like his actions aren't justified. Yes, my man! Stab, dose, explode, and yeet your way through the underbelly of Detroit. I'm with ya. That's the ruthless killer side of Eric, but what about the humanity? That's where Sarah and Albrecht come in. He has some lighthearted moments with Albrecht, to remind us that humans have a fucked up sense of humor no matter what. This scene always gets a good laugh out of me because of its effect on the bad guy.
You seriously fucked up? Did you look in the mirror? You need professional help.
Bingo!
He sucks!
He scored!
Jesus Christ!
But this scene always gets a good laugh out of me because it shows that he can tone it back, that he is still a human and has the personality that he had before.
Say, are you some kind of ghost? Boo.
And Sarah shows us a paternal side of Eric, how he must have empathized and cared about this little street tough to take her into his home, even though he has no connection to her. Sarah shows that he could form bonds before, and Albrecht shows that he can form bonds now. He's changed, but he's not unrecognizable. This is shown perfectly in the scene in the church where Eric has lost his invincibility. After being shot in the shoulder, he delivers the line, "Ah, fuck," in what might be the best line delivery of all time for me. There's disbelief, shock, and a sort of sarcastic lethargy to it that brings a sad irony to the fact that Lee himself did not survive this film. Michael Wincott as Top Dollar and David Patrick Kelly as T-Bird are also show stealers. Top Dollar is one of my favorite villains of all time. Wincott's deep, gravelly voice does things to me.
I still ain't heard the story on why Gideon's burned down. Is that a natural catastrophe or act of God or something? Call it my need to know.
And if you claim it doesn't do things to you too, you're lying. Stop lying. His delivery is as cool and calm and commanding as you'd expect from a man who knows he's at the top of the food chain. And his dynamic of not caring about money is a trait you don't often see in crime movies. He wants glory. He wants legacy. He's the one that started the first Devil's Night fire, and he's sickened by what it's become now.
Greed is for amateurs. Disorder. Chaos. Anarchy. Now that's fun!
Top Dollar is often citing conversations he had with his father as a child. Does he do what he does for his father, or because of his father? It's left ambiguous. His incestuous relationship with his witchy sister, played pitch perfectly by Bei Ling, is not left ambiguous though, and is played up to great effect.
One of the most important things I learned from my sister.
Sister? She's supposed to be your sister?
Father's daughter. That's right. What's the matter? You don't see the resemblance?
And he is just so goddamn extra.
I feel like a little worm on a big fucking hook. I feel like a little worm on a big fucking hook.
Right, for fuck's sake, die, will you? Well, you can have. Give me that thing. I'm dead!
Even his death is so goddamn extra. I love that ostentatious display of spectacle and pomp. Never fails to entertain me. David Patrick Kelly's big moment comes with his death scene. It's one of the best moments in the film. Watching the realization that he's getting his just desserts is such an intense moment. How he goes from trying to talk his way out of the situation with bravado to sobbing out in disbelief what he said the fateful night he killed Eric.
Abashed, the devil stood and felt how awful goodness is.
His eyes tear up as he stares unblinkingly ahead, and he repeats that over and over again. Here's a character that was steadfast in his belief that he would never be punished. His actions would never have consequences. He was wrong, and it's almost a religious experience. Milton said it best, "Abashed the devil stood and felt how awful goodness is." Does it get you sweaty, T-Bird? Also, I've just gotta give a nod to John Polito, who plays the pawn shop owner Gideon. Not only is he more or less a perfect physical match to how Obar drew him in the comic, he perfectly plays a different type of evil from Top Dollar or T-Bird. He plays a character whose apathy of evil finances the evil. He's buying stolen goods from the gang, Tintin specifically. And sure, he remarks upon the bloodstains on the items Tintin has, but it goes no further than that. He still pays out for it.
Well, what is this, Tintin, a bloodstain that's on here? I'll give you $50. And I hate charities.
While the character doesn't perpetrate any crimes himself, he's the perfect way to show everyday evils like greed and apathy. He owns a pawn shop, for Christ's sake. What's more evil than that? Those objects were other people's lives, and now they're collecting dust, being forgotten about because someone stole them and sold them for a few bucks. The box full of wedding rings is especially devastating. Fuck you and your everyday evil, Gideon.
Shit on me.
Shit on me!
The Crow pulls its visual style from its graphic novel source material. Gideon is a spot-on replica of his comic book double, and Eric's costume is spot-on right down to the electrical tape wrapped around his forearms. A quick side note, the tape is never explained in the movie because the skull cowboy scenes were cut, and he was going to be the one to explain it to the audience. Eric does it in the comic because he's really self-harming, but in the movie it was going to be that he weakened himself helping Sarah's mother and can't completely heal on his own, so he's taping his wounds shut.
Morphine is bad for you. Your daughter is out there on the streets waiting for you.
Despite no official explanation, it's still a high fashion look, and sometimes that's all you need. Revenge, but make it fashion.
Like the coat?
The whole movie is dark, grungy, and foreboding. It's very film noir in the official definition of the style, as in, a film marked by a mood of fatalism and menace. The cinematography accentuates that with dramatic sweeping over the tops of buildings, which is done with miniature sets and a host of visual tricks. The miniatures were such a good idea. The architectural details can be exaggerated and shot in dynamic ways. The cinematographer obviously cared and wanted to make something visually striking and memorable. I think it's pretty obvious on Blu-ray that the cityscape is miniatures, which is a shame, but on a medium that runs darker than Blu-ray, it's still an amazing looking effect. Every little detail adds to Eric's plight. Whenever he relives a memory, it's done in quick, jumpy cuts and it's lit all in red. Even when he relives loving memories with Shelley, they're all quick, jumpy, and in brutal colors, with shadows sunk in deep around the edges. It shows that now all of Eric's memories are painful, that he finds no sanctuary anywhere at any time. Little details like that can definitely make a movie, and it definitely makes The Crow. Action scenes come straight from the comic, with all the brutality you would expect in an R-rated feature. The shootout scene at Top Dollar's Club is masterful in its quick cuts done through blinking strobe lights. The strobe light effect makes everything seem like panels in a comic. How you have to show us something distinctly important in each panel before moving on to the next one with that second's worth of black in between. There's also a quality to the character design that's very intentional. Obviously, all designs are intentional. The detailing that goes into costuming is often astounding. But what I'm talking about again relates back to the comic and that type of media. Top Dollar's perfectly symmetrical hair or Eric's perfectly applied mask makeup looks like it's not controlled by the unpredictability of real life, but that it was inked by an artist's pen. It puts you in a different world right away. This big round window in the loft is also striking, and the lighting here on the rooftop is gorgeous, and this overhead shot of the crow symbol burning elicits an immediate response from me emotionally, and the constant rain collecting as droplets on everyone's hair, and this pan up past the sign and onto Eric, and the top down shots on the miniatures, and ugh, it's just all so good. I could point out something I like in literally every frame, but I'll assume you don't have the time for that and tell you something I've always disliked visually about the movie instead. Why are you unable to eat this hot dog, Sarah? I thought you were a genuine hot dogger.
See, now Sarah, she's a genuine hot dogger.
Get your head in the game, girl. There are also some awkward freeze frames thrown onto the end of a couple of Sarah's scenes, and they definitely have me baffled. I just don't see the difference between this and just cutting to the next scene. The one at the beginning is even weirder to me. Just fade to black without the freeze frame. You were already fading to black. And then there's the music. Oh, this music. The soundtrack for The Crow is more or less what has defined my musical taste through the years. The movie feels like an extended and brutal music video. So of course the musical choices match the brutality with alternative jams with sad lyrics, screeching guitar, and heavy drums. The Cure's Burn plays over the footage where we watch Eric take on the aesthetic so associated with The Crow. It's iconic. Even if Robert Smith has no memory of making the song. That's a true fact. He got a request for it at a live show once and he asked, "Is that one of ours?" And according to my mother, who made many a pilgrimage to see live Cure shows in the 80s, they never played Love Cats because they couldn't remember the bass line. But they recorded Burn and it's right there at the beginning of the soundtrack album, so we've got it now, and the band's inability to get their shit together is not our problem. Then, just a few scenes later, Nine Inch Nails' cover of Joy Division's Dead Souls drones on while Eric recklessly traverses the city via rooftop. Also iconic. Then there's the concert slash gunfight at Top Dollar's club slash lair, where we hear the thumping, screeching industrial metal of After the Flesh by My Life with the Thrill Kill Cult. I think you can guess that it's also fucking iconic. And that's just the soundtrack. There's still the original score, which Graham Revell just completely fucking nailed. Nailed it so hard the man outdid a nail gun. It's tribal at parts, hymnal at other parts, noir at other parts still, and just a little bit feral all the way through. It's such a beautiful soundtrack, and a huge part of why I always tear up at the end is because of the gentle string piece Believe in Angels. I'm just so fucking soft for every element of this movie. It's been almost 30 years since The Crow was first released, and it completely holds up all this time later. It's an intense story of love and revenge given life by some talented performances, a haunting musical score, and beautiful sets and camera tricks that I don't think any other movie could pull off. It's a movie about coming back from the dead, and while Lee's death was tragic, I can't think of a more fitting epitaph for him than The Crow. But what does any of this have to do with the horror genre? Although not horror per se, The Crow is a piece of media that lurks in the shadows, very close to horror. It's filled with themes and images that we often see in horror movies. Brutal attacks, cold-blooded murder, blood.
I suppose you write it up as graffiti.
It's just that instead of showing it with monsters or ghosts, it's shown through regular humans. These humans have reached an extreme, but it's an extreme within the realm of reality. There is horror in the acts that T-Bird and his crew do, and then horror in what that turns Eric into. The evils that men do to each other is the most horrifying thing in the world.
Victims, aren't we all?
If the people we love are stolen from us by these evils, the way to have them live on is to never stop loving them. Buildings burn, people die, but real love is forever. The Crow, City of Angels is next, and that real love will be sorely tested.
Pick a card, Monkey. Lady Lux, a bitch. Oh.
And that's The Crow. You know, The Crow was almost entirely abandoned after Lee's death, but it was his mother and widow that pushed the project to completion because of their love for Brandon. I also pushed myself to completion of this retrospective for my love of Brandon Lee. I had to pause recording voiceover about a dozen times because I was getting weepy, and I just kind of had to stiff upper lip it to the end. I'm a total fucking baby for this movie. Let me know in the comments if you are too, because I want to know that I'm not alone in this. Like always, like, comment, and subscribe here on YouTube, follow me on Instagram and Twitter, and check out my other creative endeavor, a podcast titled Scooby-Doos or Scooby-Don'ts. I'm sure you fully understand what it's about from title alone. Until next time, don't let the ghoulies get you down.